Hello everybody, this is Johns Hopkins with Baltimore Heritage, and we're back with another of our 5-minute histories videos. And today we're going to talk about Brown's Arcade. Behind me, I'm on North Charles Street, just north of Saratoga Street. But before we get to that, I'd like to share a comment from one of our listeners. A gentleman named Jim phoned in last week and said thanks for the videos, and thank you, Jim, for the kind words. He also said thanks for sharing so much Baltimore history trivia. And although I want to say thanks to Jim, I want to offer humbly one correction, that what we're doing with these videos is not trivia. I looked up the definition of trivia, and Merriam-Webster's dictionary says trivia is a piece of information of little importance or value. And I'm gonna, again, humbly suggest that what we're talking about, Baltimore's history and architecture and heritage, does have importance as we plot our way forward, and maybe even some practical value. Now, if you know that bears eat people, that is a piece of information that has some urgency if you're hiking in Yellowstone and there's a bear coming at you down the trail. Some of the information we learn maybe doesn't have quite as much urgency, but could have some value. So, for example, today we're going to learn that Brown's Arcade is the oldest and last surviving historic arcade in the state of Maryland. That might not have super urgency, but if you're hosting your Aunt Mildred from Albuquerque and you're walking up Charles Street to go to the Walters, and she asks you if you know anything about these great historic buildings you're walking past, and you say, "Ah, Aunt Mildred, I do in fact know. Let's talk about Brown's Arcade." She's going to be so impressed that she's going to treat you to a beer at Nick O'Shea's right here on the corner before you go up to the Walters. So there, I'll urge Jim and all of you, tuck these pieces of information away. They will come back with value sooner or later. All right, Brown's Arcade, it was built in 1904, or actually combined four buildings in 1904 to form the arcade. But let's talk about arcades in general. Arcades are as old as the millennia. Think about in ancient Greece and Rome, the Colosseum, the wonderful arched pedestrian way on the base of the Colosseum, and that's what an arcade is, an arched pedestrian way. But also think of some arcades in other cultures. The Great Mosque of Kairouan, and I think I'm saying that probably wrong, in Tunisia, or think of the Buddhist temples in places like Tibet and in Vietnam and Laos, all with wonderful pedestrian arcades. Shopping arcades got their starts in sort of Renaissance Italy. The loggia, open-air loggia, were shopping arcades that the Medici family really liked. Maybe even before that, there were things called butter walks in medieval Europe, in England and Northern Europe, presumably places where shoppers could have some shelter getting their daily butter. But shopping arcades in the modern way really got started in Paris, in France, in 1784 with the building of the conversion into the Palais Royal, one of the first big showy arcades. And then just 2 years later, the Galeries de Bois, and I know I'm saying that wrong, but 1786 in Paris really kicked off shopping in arcades in a big way. In the United States, we got our first arcade in 1828 in Providence, Rhode Island. It was called the Westminster Arcade. I think today it's called the Providence Arcade. You can still go and visit it. That's the first enclosed shopping center in the United States. In Baltimore, we got our first arcade in the 1830s with a place called the Bazaar, which was on Fayette Street in the Jones Falls. It's sadly no longer with us. And then we come to 1904. And Frank Brown builds this arcade. Frank Brown is a Postmaster General of Baltimore. He was a member of the House of Delegates in Annapolis, and he was the governor of Maryland for 4 years. And he was a good businessman. In 1904, he looked just to the south and saw the burnt district where the great fire that happened in February of 1904 had destroyed so much, but that Baltimore was committed to rebuilding. And he saw a mercantile opportunity in these four houses here. They were built, the first one, right around 1810, so quite old. And they were built as something called messuages. A messuage is a parcel of land or a house that's on a church estate, but it's set aside for a household. And in fact, this parcel was parcel number 19 in the original Baltimore town back in 1730. And some of Baltimore's earliest Catholics bought it. They built St. Peter's Church here, the first Catholic church in Baltimore. And then they carved out these lots and built houses on them for various households. By the time Frank Brown came along in 1904, they were no longer owned by the church and they were no longer in church use. In fact, St. Peter's had been torn down in 1845, I believe, to build a Catholic school that became Calvert Hall. So those of you who know Calvert Hall, that's now in Towson, that's what got its start down here. And when Brown bought them, he saw a mercantile opportunity. This part of Charles Street was known as Baltimore's Fifth Avenue, and it was really for high-end shopping. He combined all four houses, put a new storefronts on them, neo-colonial in style, and then built a passageway from Charles Street to the rear, where that old school building was when he bought it, and then put shops on the inside. This offered a number of advantages. It was sheltered from the rain for shoppers. It was sheltered from the noise of Charles Street. And it gave the interior spaces a value that that they wouldn't have had before. So Brown creates offices on the upper stories and then shops down here, fitting into the high-end shopping here. One such store was Guth Chocolates. They were a high-end chocolatier specializing in bonbons. So if you were a bonbon fan and you could afford it, this is where you'd go. Things went well until after World War II. And that's when Baltimore's wealthier families started moving north, and the shops that serviced them also moved north with them. And so this arcade experienced some roller coaster ups and downs. In the 1980s, it had a steam pipe explosion underneath it, very odd, but survived that. In the 1990s, it survived a fire. And today, we're going to end on a good note. It is being redeveloped by a firm called, I think, GL Capital. And they are turning what were offices on the top floors into apartments. And they are redoing, hopefully back to their wonderful 1904 appearance, the shops on the ground level. So thanks so much, and we'll see you next time.